for sharing our such knowledge. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much. Thank you so much. Shall I leave now?
Yeah, madam, you can leave now. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Yeah, yeah.
Thank you. Okay.
कोकरे सर जॉइन झाले
दिसत नाही सर सध्या
येतात येतात दोन मिनिटात येतो म्हणलं तर कॉल आला तो ही विल बी जॉइनिंग शुअर इन 5 मिनिट्स
येस गुड सेशन्स ऑल All participants are attentive. What I observed. You are giving instruction in between. Very good.
Yes, sir.
Good, good. बारा टक्के सर फक्त दोन तीन मिनिटच आहे ओकरे सर जॉईन होत आहेत
इयर पार्टिसिपंट्स और नेक्स्ट रिसर्व पर्सन इज गोइंग टू जॉईन व्हेरी सून
जोक्स आर नॉट अलाउड
हॅलो
जोक्स आर नॉट अलाउड
आय एम ऑडिबल सर
येस
येस येस येस
येस येस यू आर ऑडिबल कोऑपरेशन हु विल बी जॉइनिंग
सर ही हैज नॉट जॉइंड येस ही विल बी जॉइनिंग व्हेरी सून
ओके सर
बारा टक्के सर सुरू होत आहे दोनच मिनिट ओकरे साहेब जॉईन होत आहेत काहीतरी सिग्नल पाठवा म्हणतंय पार्टिसिपंटला बारा टक्के सर म्हणतायत करवणकर सर काहीतरी सिग्नल पाठवा म्हणतात बारा टक्के सर सो यू
Kokare sir is having some network issue. He is trying to connect through his mobile. He will be joining in few seconds. We are continuously communicating with our expert.
Okay, Baitakke sir.
Till the Kokare sir is joining, one announcement is there. Tomorrow the session will start at 10 a.m. I'm like 2 days sessions where we have started at 10:30. Tomorrow session will start at 10 a.m.
Have you checked the timetable, sir?
Yes.
Sir,
we are getting.
Is it as per timetable, 10 o'clock?
Yes, as per timetable.
Okay.
Hello.
Yes, Kokre sir, we are hearing you. Yes,
welcome.
Okay.
Yeah, so welcome, Kokre sir. Yeah, we are getting your voice. I am making you a presenter.
Okay.
Now you can share your screen, sir. Share your screen.
Yes. It's correct. It's correct.
Your screen is now visible.
Yeah.
Yes, sir. Your screen is visible.
Yes, sir.
Shall we start the session?
Yeah, no problem, sir.
No problem. Oh, there is some problem in voice. It's not clear.
Are you getting my voice clearly, sir?
No, sir. There is some depth in the voice.
Okay.
वॉइस ठीक है ना करवणकर सर?
हाँ नहीं है, पोहोचत नहीं है.
नहीं मला तर क्लियर येत आहे, तुमच्या तिकडे प्रॉब्लेम आहे का? बरं बघा.
नाही क्लियर
माझा क्लियर दिसतोय. त्यांना वेलकम करायला लावत होतो अमृताला. ओके.
Welcome one and all on behalf of Government College of Engineering Karad. Moving towards the fourth and last session of today, Signal, Image and Video Processing, A Practical Approach 2020. I welcome our today's guest, Dr. Manish Kukre sir. A brief introduction of today's guest. Dr. Manish Kukre, born in Pune, 11th August 1972, received his diploma in Industrial Electronics Engineering from the Board of Technical Examination Maharashtra, BE and ME degree in Electronics from Shri Guru Gobind Singh Ji Institute of Engineering and Technology, Nanded, in 1993 and 99. Next, since June 93 to 95, he worked with the industry. Before that, he completed a job. Postdoctoral research work in 2011-12 in the University of California, USA. Now next, he worked with the industry in June 93 to 95. After that, he started his career in academics as a lecturer in Department of Electronics and Telecommunication Engineering at SGGS Institute of Engineering and Technology, Nanded. There he is presently holding the position of Professor and the Head of Department of Electronics and Telecommunication Engineering, Coordinator of Center of Excellence in Signal and Image Processing, and a Coordinator of RUSA. He also Dean of Research and Development of Institute from 2016-18. He has published about 85 papers in international and national journals and conferences. His research citations are 2000+, H-Index 20 and I-10 Index 32. He received his prestigious career award for young teachers for the year 2005 from All India Council for Technical Education, AICTE, New Delhi. In December 2009, he honored with Best Achievers of SGGS Alumni. He also received Boy Scouts Fellowship. Recently, Dr. Kokhare has been honored with the Best Teacher Award by Swami Ramanand Tirth Marathwada University, Nanded in September 2013. Under his supervision, 10 research scholars completed PhD in Electronics and Computer Engineering, and presently 6 research scholars are working towards their PhD. Acknowledging Dr. Kokhare's research contribution, he has been selected as a reviewer of 20 international journals like IEEE Transaction. He visited many countries to present his research work like Cambridge University, UK, University of Barcelona, Spain, University of California, USA, Bangkok, University of California, Santa Barbara, USA, Stanford University, USA, then University of California, Berkeley, USA, and National University, Singapore, NTU, Singapore, and UTP, Malaysia. So his research interests include the wavelets, image processing, pattern recognition, computer vision, content-based image retrieval. For the benefit of faculty members and research scholars, in engineering, he had conducted more than 250 professional workshops and short-term training programs in various engineering colleges of India. Based on this significant research contribution, recently Dr. Kokhare has been chosen as a candidate whose biography is included in 2007 edition Who's Who in the World, which is published in November 2006. So this is brief introduction of today's our speaker. Now I request Kokhare sir to start the session. Please sir.
Thank you very much for inviting me and introducing me. So good afternoon to all. I hope am I audible to you people?
Yeah, you are audible.
Okay, sir. Present on the screen. So the topic which on which I'll be talking about is wavelets and its application. Particularly in the image processing and signal processing. Okay. So just one minute, let me share my my screen is shared with these or not?
No, your screen is not shared.
Okay, make me present the message.
You are a presenter.
It's not coming here.
Please check the share option, sir.
Now it is coming. Okay, so I hope that now.
Yeah.
Okay. So, wavelet, basically, I'll be talking about wavelet and its application. So first question comes up in our mind that what is wavelet? Okay. So wavelet is a mathematical tool. Okay. We came across this one. Two various tools in first year engineering while doing the workshop and so on. So those tools were used for doing particular kind of job. So Weblet is also a mathematical tool, okay, which is used for doing the analysis and synthesis of the signals. Okay. That signals may be your one-dimensional signal or maybe a two-dimensional signal or maybe n-dimensional signal. Since Weblet transform is a separable transform, so we can apply this Weblet transform for one-dimensional signal or two-dimensional signal or n-dimensional signal. And sometimes this is also called as a mathematical microscope. Weblet is also called as a mathematical microscope because this Weblet transform visualizes the signal with multiple scale. You know that microscope does the thing is basically if we change the scale, we can see the tiny things which are not possible to see with our naked eyes. So by changing the scale, we'll be able to see that with our this one, with the help of microscope. In the same way, we can visualize the signals at multiple scales with the help of Weblet. And that's why it is called as a mathematical microscope. And this mathematical microscope is really useful in several applications of signal processing. Maybe now signal processing, it's not signal processing, it's only electrical engineering or computer engineering or electronics engineering. Because signal source, for example, if you consider the mechanical engineering and then if you have measured the vibration signal by attaching the vibration sensor to the machine, you will record that signal. So definitely the amplitude of that signal will be recorded with respect to time. So after all, this is the one-dimensional signal, and then computer or Weblet doesn't know whether it is coming from mechanical engineering or whether it is coming from electrical engineering, does not matter. So we can use that Weblet for doing the analysis of vibration of signals. Earlier people from mechanical side, they used to use this FFT for doing analysis of vibration. But nowadays, Weblet is also used as one of the tools for doing the vibration analysis. So we can use Weblet in electrical engineering, we can use Weblet in electronics, computer, IT, or e-groups, plus mechanical engineering. Also, suppose for example, if there is an earthquake, and then you get the seismic signal, which is plotted with respect to time. So that is also one-dimensional signal. So Weblet can be used for doing the analysis of seismic signal also. So it's not related. Weblet is not related only with electrical engineering or electronics engineering or any e-group. It can be used wherever there is a signal for doing the analysis of that signal. Particularly, this is useful when the signal is non-stationary. Okay, we'll see that non-stationary signal and all those things. So, in summary, Weblet is used for doing the analysis and synthesis of one-dimensional signal or two-dimensional signal or n-dimensional signal, and also it can be used in various disciplines. One more thing I'd like to tell you, okay, basically clarify, most of the people must be knowing about the analysis. In most of lecture, I give this example of what is my analysis of the signal. See that, when we speak, okay, and when if there is a microphone which is a record, which is used for recording purpose of the signal, so this recorded signal, you don't get this a simple signal, but it consists of several frequencies. This recorded signal is a combination of several frequencies. Now, basically for this one, finding the frequency components, okay, we need to do the analysis of this signal. So, analysis of the signal is exactly, so for example, if I give the example of cup of tea, okay, how do you do the analysis of this cup of tea? So if I ask you people to do the analysis of this cup of tea, so this analysis can be done that this cup of tea contains half cup water, half cup milk, 2 teaspoon sugar, 1 teaspoon tea, and then some masala in that, and then this is boiled with some temperature. So like that way, so we have found the ingredients of this cup of tea. These ingredients are sugar, tea, then this one, all those components are there. So separation of these ingredients from the product is nothing but the analysis. And synthesis is exactly opposite. Means if I add half cup water, then half cup milk, then 2 teaspoon sugar, 1 teaspoon tea, then some other in that, and then after that, if I boil that mixture, I'll get the cup of tea back. So this process is called as the synthesis. So in signal processing or image processing also, we need to do this analysis as well as synthesis. So analysis means basically we are trying to find out the ingredients which are called as the features. And these features are generally used for recognition purpose, maybe prediction purpose, maybe for identification purpose, and so on. So wherever you would like to use this, wavelet for recognition purpose and so on. So the main job of wavelet is to extract the feature of the signal or image. So that is the main job. Now, for studying this wavelet, which are the good books available? Here I have shown you three books. You know that on a wavelet, in 2005, when I got a career offer young teacher, at that time, this career offer young teacher, so Stanford 5 lakh rupees award, and in that award, every year 50,000 rupees are allocated for purchasing the books. So in 2005, I was searching only the books on wavelets, and at that time, I came to know here about 20,000 titles were available on the wavelet in 2005. Now see that. Means now it's already 2020. 15 years back. So many books are available. So who has written all those books? Particularly wavelet is designed by the mathematician and used by engineers or physicists. So mathematical people have designed, written the books. Engineers have written the books, physicists have written the books, and so on. So out of that, I'll not suggest you all those heavy books, but here I have given a sample of three books. The first book, that is Wavelet Transform, An Introduction to Theory and Application, which is written by Rao and Bobudikar. So for beginners, this book is a really good book for understanding the concept of wavelet. Those who want to study wavelet in more details, like for example, Cosine-modulated wavelet, or M-band wavelet, M-channel wavelet, and so on. For them, the second book is a good book, that is Wavelets and Filter Bank, that is written by Gilbert Stang. This book is a good book for those who want to study wavelet with mathematical concepts and so on. And the third book, which I have shown here, that is nothing but the PhD thesis of Sidney, this one, Gopinath. So he was doing his PhD at the Rice University, USA, under the supervision of Professor Sidney Burrows. And then he designed several wavelets during 90s, 1998. And then at the end of his PhD, he converted his PhD thesis into a book. And so in that book, you find a lot of wavelets or a lot of information about the M-channel wavelet or Cosine-modulated wavelet and so on. So several wavelets he has designed. So that book is for studying, you can refer for studying that M-channel wavelet from that book. So these are the three books which are really good. There is also one more book which is written by an Indian author. I think that author is from Chennai. So that is also a good book. I don't remember the exact name of that author, but it is Introduction to Wavelet Transform. I don't remember exactly. But those who hate mathematics, for them, see, all those wavelets, you'll find so many equations of pi and psi and everything is there and so on. Basically mathematics is compulsory subject for engineering, but I know that many people hate mathematics, and then even while doing the research, whenever they read the paper, most of the time they skip the mathematical equation and they try to read only the theoretical part. But with this attitude, I'm doubtful whether they really understood the paper or not. But yes, for understanding the wavelet without mathematics, there is one very good book which is written by a lady who is neither a mathematician nor engineer. She is just art graduated. Now question comes in our mind that a person who is just art graduated, how that person can write a book? But her major qualification was her husband, who is a great mathematician. So he used to basically do the interpretation of all of those mathematical equations, and she used to write all those in a simple text form. So that book is, the name of that book is The World According to Gavlik. The title of that book is World. I don't know whether it is visible or not, but okay, I'm just reading it. World According to Gavlik. According to Gavlik. Okay, and the author is by Barbara Hubbard. Barbara Hubbard. Hubbard. Okay, so this book is really a good book for the beginners. So, okay, in this book, Gavlik is explained very nicely without any mathematical equations or like that. So that that book is really a good book. This one for beginners. Now, if you look at the history of this Gavlik, okay, so you know that this one, the first tool which was developed for doing the analysis of the signal was in 1807 by this Jean Baptiste Joseph Fourier. Okay, so this. In 1807, this Jean Baptiste Joseph Fourier, a French mathematician, he claimed that any repeating waveform can be represented or can be expressed as an infinite sum of sine and cosine waves of various frequencies. Okay, so that was the first tool for doing the analysis of the signals. Okay, but you know that generally, when things are invented first time, you get opposition, and his publication was also denied. And in 1822, his Fourier's work was finally published. And then after that, after 143 years, in 1965, Kolitoki developed a first Fourier transform algorithm, and generally we have studied that one in our DSP course. Okay. Then after that, in 1909, a Hungarian mathematician, Alfred Haar, he introduced a Haar wavelet. But at that time, this function was not well known as a Haar wavelet, because the first wavelet was designed in 1984, but in 1909, Hungarian mathematician Alfred Haar, he introduced a small function like as a having amplitude equal to plus 1, function having amplitude equal to plus 1 from 0 to t by 2 and minus 1 from t by 2 to t. So simple function, this is a very simple function having amplitude equal to plus 1 from 0 to t by 2 and minus 1 from t by 2 to t. So this function was used for doing the analysis and synthesis of this one. Okay, so from implementation point of view, this Haar function is really simple because it has a coefficient like as a 1 and a minus 1 filter coefficients. So it is not expensive from implementation point of view, and also it is easy to implement. But the problem with this one is that when you use this function for analysis and synthesis, when you synthesize that signal, or for example, in case of image, when you reconstruct that image, you don't get the clear image, you get the blocking artifacts in that image, because this function is basically not overlapping with each other. So you get the blocking artifact effect in that, and then the clarity of the image is not that very good. Okay. Then after that, in 1936, Dennis Gabor, who is a British-Hungarian physicist, introduced a Gabor transform. At that time also, basically, nowadays Gabor wavelet is well known. But this one, in 1946, this was simple, a Gabor transform. And this Gabor, nowadays this Gabor wavelet is used. But see that, for example, if you are decomposing the image, with gamma regulated source. For example, if you have an image size of 128 by 128. Okay, this is your original image size 128 by 128. And you have designed a Gabor wavelet with orientation theta is equal to 6. Means there are 6 orientations and with scale S is equal to 4. That is 4 scales you have designed this Gabor wavelet. So after decomposing image with Gabor wavelet for 6 orientation, at first scale S is equal to 1, you got 6 subbands. That is subband 1 which is oriented in theta 1 direction, subband 2 which is oriented in theta 2 direction, so like that there is 6 subband which is oriented in theta 6 direction. So this is the representation at scale 1. Now this is giving information at scale 1 in 6 direction. Also at scale 2, okay, this is further decomposed and you get subband 1 with theta 1 direction, but now scale is 1, then theta, okay, subband 2, theta 2 direction, and then subband 6 with theta 6 direction. Okay, so at scale 2, you got 6 more subbands. Now you have designed this Gabor wavelet or basically S is equal to 3 and S is equal to 4. Means there are 4 scales. Now at each scale, you are getting 6 subbands. So 4 scale in total, you have 24 subbands because at each scale you have 6 subbands. And the size of this subband in case of this one, Gabor wavelet is same like as the original image. Now if your original image is 128 by 128, this is also 128 by 128. Now see that. At scale 1, your subband 1 is also having size equal to 128 by 128. Second subband is also having size equal to 128 by 128. Third subband is also having size equal to 128 by 128. And final, sixth subband is also having size equal to 128. Same thing is there for scale 2, same thing is there for scale 3, same thing is there for scale 4 and so on. So in total, you got 24 subband with 6 scale, 4 scales and 6 orientation, you got 24 subband. And now see that, for example, if you consider a grayscale image here, original image is grayscale image, so 128 by 128 image will require basically 128 by 128 bytes of memory. Now for storing this 24 subband, every subband will require same memory like as the original image because its size is also same. So total memory required to store all those 24 subband will be 24 times more than the original image. So memory requirement is increased. Why is this happening? Just 1 minute. I'm getting this one. Can you please, sir? Can you please the writing on board? Madam, I'm not getting it. Dr. Sunil Kore. This board is not visible?
Exactly.
Yes, sir. Board is not actually visible. Since we have shared your screen, that's why.
Actually, for this one, because I don't have this pen to write on the laptop. Anyway, I'll try to explain the things. Okay. Okay. Anyway, I'll try to explain. Okay. So, okay. In total, there are 24 subbands in case of Gabor wavelet, and 24 subbands are there in the Gabor wavelet. So, definitely, the memory required to store the Gabor wavelet decomposed subbands will be 24 times more than the original image. Why is this happening? Because Gabor wavelet is not an orthogonal transform. Okay. And hence representation is not compact in case of Gabor wavelet, and hence it requires more memory to store that. Okay. So that was the problem with Gabor wavelet. Then in 1984, the first wavelet was designed by Marlett and Grossman. So they uttered first time the wavelet word in 1984. So you can say that the birth of wavelet is in 1984. Okay. But then why we are calling that as Hart wavelet, which was designed at 1909? Because the Hart function basically satisfies the properties of wavelet That's why this R function is also later on called as the R wavelet. Okay. So, in 1984, the first wavelet was designed by Grossman and Warren and Grossman. But this wavelet was not a compact wavelet. Okay. And then, at the same time, this 1984, Mayer discovered a new kind of wavelet with a mathematical property called as the orthogonality. Orthogonality means the information captured by one function is completely independent of information captured by another function. So if two functions, dot product of these two functions is zero, then we say that these two functions are basically orthogonal to each other. So definitely the information captured by one function will not be overlapped with the information captured by another function. So this representation is really good, which does not increase any kind of memory. So this was the development in 1984 by Professor Mayer, who discovered the kind of new kind of wavelet having the orthogonality property. Okay, in 1984. Now, after that, in 1986, Stephen Mallet, who was doing postdoctoral research work with Professor Mayer at that time. Now he is having his own company in USA. He has also written one book on wavelet, and the title of that book is A Tour of the Wavelet by Stephen Mallet. Okay. So he discovered a new algorithm. See that development of wavelet was at one hand and the use of wavelet was at other hand. So there was a gap between the actual wavelet and the use of wavelet. So how to use that wavelet for application purpose? So he developed a new algorithm that is called as the Mallet's pyramidal algorithm. So he proposed that yes, wavelet can be represented as a free pyramid, and then we can use wavelet for representation of the signals at multiple scale, and then we can extract the features or extract the information at multiple scale. So that was the development in 1986. He proposed a Mallet's pyramidal algorithm, and then people started using wavelet for various applications. Then this final breakthrough came in 1987. This study whose name is Ingrid Dobocic. Okay, you might have heard in MATLAB also DB is there. So DB is not decibel in case of wavelet, it is a Dobocic wavelet. She designed several wavelets, okay, and not only that one, she also proposed that wavelet can be implemented by using simple filtering concept. Low-pass filtering and high-pass filtering. So she proposed that yes, so Dobocic, Ingrid Dobocic, the final great salute in the wavelet revolution, designed a new class of wavelet which are not only orthogonal but can be implemented using a simple digital filter ideas. So that was her contribution, and then people started using wavelet plot in this. But up to that one, this was a real wavelet. Okay. Then, you know that, okay, in 1965, one of the experiment was carried out by Ubel. And then he studied the brain model, how our brain basically works and so on. So, what is the near mathematical model of this brain? So, he proposed that our brain is basically a combination or bunch of several nonlinear filters. It is a combination of several nonlinear filters, and each filter is giving a maximum response to particular frequency and particular orientation. So second filter is given for second frequency and second orientation. So we can recognize the object in all directions. So basically this brain is having a mathematical model which is equivalent to the bunch of filters. All those filters are tuned for particular frequency and particular orientation. And this is exactly same, or it is more similar to the Gabor wavelet. And that's why you know that Gabor wavelet gives more accurate result than the standard real wavelet. Because Gabor wavelet gives more directional information, six directional information. So for example, if you have designed a Gabor wavelet for six direction, you get the six directional information. But in case of real wavelet, you get, if you are using that mirror wavelet for the image processing, then you get only information in horizontal direction, vertical direction, or diagonal direction. So only in three directions you get the information, But in case of Gabor Wavelet, if your design is Gabor Wavelet for 6 orientation, you get the 6 directional orientation. But for human being, okay, do you think that we get only horizontal information or vertical information, or we recognize the object only in horizontal direction or vertical direction or direct diagonal direction? No. We recognize the object in all directions. So definitely, our mathematical model, if it is giving more directional information, it will be more close to the human being. Okay? Whereas in standard wavelet, we get the information only in horizontal direction or vertical direction or diagonal direction. That was the basically that is the concept in the real wavelet. But in the case of Gabor wavelet, you can design the Gabor wavelet for any kind of orientation. So for example, if you design a Gabor wavelet for 12 directional information, but what will happen if you increase the number of orientation, number of subbands will increase, and if you increase the number of subbands, memory requirement will be also increased. Okay, accuracy as compared to the real wavelet. But if you are thinking about the Gabor wavelet, okay, memory requirement or computational, okay, if you do extract the features and from the all subbands, computational complexity increases 24 times almost if you are using this 6 directional wavelet or like that. But here the computation complexity is increased by 2 times, and then you are getting the 6 orientation here. So if you have designed the wavelet or Gabor wavelet for 6 orientation, and if you use the complex wavelet also for 6 orientation, definitely complex wavelet will give better result because its computation complexity is less as compared to the Gabor. Okay, so that was the development in 1997. Okay, and then in next generation, 21st generation century, this new wavelets are designed. Okay, like for example, multi wavelet is there, advanced wavelet is there, or ridgelet is there, wavelet is there, okay, or edgelet is there, wavelet is there. There are so many wavelets available. Okay, so our last one is the rotated complex wavelet. This is the wavelet which I designed during my PhD at IIT Kharagpur, and then this paper has been published in Analytical Transactional System and Analytics. Application of this wavelet, which I use for obtaining the rotation invariant feature of X-ray magnetic retrieval, that is also published in another IIT Kharagpur and so on. Now the concept of this rotated wavelet is that, or rotated, now this one, rotated complex wavelet is that we have obtained the pair of complex wavelet such that it is 45 degree apart from the original complex wavelet. It gives the information 45 degree apart from the original complex wavelet. See that original complex wavelet gives the information in plus minus 45 degree, plus minus 75 degree, and plus minus 60 degree. So like that way you get information in original complex wavelet. But we have obtained the pair of wavelets which are 45 degree apart from the original complex wavelet. So we get another 6 directional information. Now see that compression complexity of wavelet is 2 times as compared to the compression complexity of real wavelet, and compression complexity of complex wavelet is also 2 times as compared to the, if you are implementing in frequency domain, it is also 2 times as compared to the real wavelet. Okay. Now if I combine this together, I will get 6 directional information with complex wavelet, dual to complex wavelet, and another 6 directional information I will get with the rotated complex wavelet. So in total, I will get 12 directional information. Now, when I am characterizing the object in 12 different directions, definitely it will give me a strong set of features, and that will improve the accuracy. Okay. Now, what is the total compression complexity increase with this one, complex wavelet and rotated complex wavelet? That is 4 times as compared to the standard wavelet. But if we use a Gabor wavelet of 6 orientation, it is increasing 24 times. Okay. So, that way we compared our result, and we got better result as compared to this one. So this is the, okay, this was up to 2005, later on people, okay, developed so many wavelets and so on. Okay, after all, what is a transform and why do we need that transform? What is the role of transform? What do you think, what is my transform? So transform is nothing but basically a mathematical operation that takes a function or sequence and maps. See, this is mathematical operation which maps into the another domain. So from mapping information from one domain to another domain, so that mathematical operation is called as the transform. Okay. Now when you take basically inverse of that one, you should get the invertible, this one. If transform is invertible transform, you should get the same data. Okay. So basically why these transforms are basically used, and then what are the, how many transforms are available? See that. I mean, in total, how many transforms are available right now? We are familiar with Fourier transform, we are familiar with Schottky Fourier transform, we are familiar with this one, Wavelet transform or TCT, sine transform, Radomir transform, shape transform, Hadamard transform, and so on. So, how many transforms are there? There are thousands of transforms available, okay? And even in Wavelet itself, there are more than 250 Wavelets available. Right now, you look and see that standard wavelet is there, standard wavelet, then M channel wavelet is there, in M channel wavelet, M band wavelet is there, Poisson wavelet is there, Gabor wavelet is there, Haar wavelet is there, singlet is there, wavelet is there, rotated complex wavelet is there, multi wavelet is there. So there are so many wavelets, more than 250 wavelets are available right now to do the analysis. Every day, new wavelet is taking a birth, but if it satisfies the criteria of wavelet, then it will survive, otherwise it will die. Okay? So, thousands of transforms are available. Then, how does all those transforms look like? Okay, all those transforms, okay, look same in similar way. Okay? So, that we'll see later on. But basically, why transforms are good? Okay, what is the role of this transform? Because see that, for example, if I utter a word and if I record a speech signal, I get so many frequencies, and in time domain, if I ask, okay, if somebody asks that, what, how many frequencies are there in your signal? So it is very difficult to tell, okay, how many frequencies are there in that my time domain signal, okay, because in original domain, it is not possible for me to tell, okay, that many frequencies are there. But if I take the Fourier transform of that one, okay, I'll be able to get how many frequencies are available in that signal. Means the things which were not visible in original domain are now visible in transform domain. So that is the beauty of transform. Means we, okay, the things which are hidden can be made visible. So the transform of a function gives the additional information or hidden information about the original function which may not be available in the original domain. So that is one thing. Second thing in the transform is that, okay, you know that transform is okay. Transform of an equation may be easier to solve than the original equation. Take the example that most of the people have studied the control system in third year. Okay, in third year, when you do the mathematical modeling of physical systems, you get the integral differential equation. And if system is of higher order, this integral differential equation order is very very high. Now, solving this higher order integral differential equation is really difficult. But if you take the Laplace transform of this integral differential equation, then this integral differential equation will be converted into simple algebraic equation. You know that d by dt in Laplace transform is represented by s, d2 by dt square is represented by s square, and so on. So, whatever this integral differential, higher order integral differential equation was there, that can be represented with a simple algebraic equation. Now, solving simple algebraic equation is easy as compared to the higher order integral differential equation. Now, this was possible because if we take the Laplace transform of this integral differential equation, we got the algebraic equation. Then, after that, we can solve that one, and then finally, we can take the inverse of that one and get the solution. Okay. So, that makes our life easy. Another thing is that, see, you might have seen that, okay, DCT. DCT is used in compression or wavelet, okay, in JPEG 2000 wavelet is used for compression purpose. Okay. What they do is, basically, they represent the data in a very small coefficient. So, data compression is achieved with the help of transform. So, transform is very, or transform of a function or sequence may require less storage and hence provide the compression. So, that is the beauty of the transform. Another thing is that you might have seen, okay, in a convolution, in the time domain, what you have to do, you have two sequences, then when you would like to do the convolution of that one. So, what you have to do, you have to pull back one sequence and then you have to multiply and add, shift, multiply, and then after that you have to do all those things. So, entirely, once it is over, you get the convolution result. is in case of time domain. But this is time consuming and all those things. But this same thing can be done in a frequency domain if you take basically a Fourier transform of one sequence and Fourier transform of another sequence. So Fourier transform, if you have two Fourier transform of two different sequences, if you multiply that one, you will get the convolution. So convolution is equivalent to the multiplication in Fourier domain. So this becomes very, very easy. The things which are complicated becomes easy because of transform. The things which are not visible becomes visible in the transform domain. And things which requires more space, okay, in transform domain, it will require less space and so on. And that's why transforms are very, very useful for handling the signals of any dimension, maybe signal, maybe your one dimensional signal, or maybe your two dimensional or n dimensional. So that's why transforms are very, very useful. And now, see that, how does transform looks like, any transform, okay? So basically, see that, you know that this transform, if you look at any transform, so if I, for example, if I have a signal like a sinusoidal wave and having a frequency or time period equal to 1 millisecond. 1 millisecond is the time period of this one. So apparently its frequency will be 1 kilohertz. Okay. Now, can I take the Fourier transform of this one? This signal. This is the time domain signal, one dimensional signal. I can take a Fourier transform. So for example, this is f of t original signal. This will be mapped into the Fourier domain, and this map is f of omega, which is given by, so for example, continuous in continuous case, okay, 0 to, okay, in one dimensional, 0 to infinity, f of t, e raised to minus j omega t dt. Okay, e raised to, see, Fourier transform equation is f of omega is equal to 0 to infinity in one dimension, I'm talking about f of t into e raised to minus say omega t dt. So this f of t is the signal to be analyzed. And then this e raised to minus j omega t, what is this e raised to minus j omega t? Some people call it as a basis function, some people call it as a kernel function. Then what is exactly, whether it is a basis function or kernel function? Okay, we'll see later on. Okay, can I take the Laplace transform of this signal, same signal f of t of 1 kilohertz having a time period of 1 millisecond? Can I take the Laplace transform of this one? Yes. This will be mapped in an S domain, f of s is equal to, now it is again integration from 0 to infinity, f of t will be there, and here e raised to minus st dt. This will be the mathematical equation of my, this one, Laplace transform. See, first Fourier transform is f of omega is equal to integration from 0 to infinity, f of t e raised to minus j omega t. And for same this one, if I take the Laplace transform, my equation will be f of s 0 to infinity f of t e raised to minus st, e raised to minus st dt. If I take the Laplace transform, what will happen? See that here, basically, what will change? The appearance of both the transform is same. There is an integration of Fourier transform, okay? Then signal to be analyzed, that is f of t, and after that there is a kernel function. Here also, that this kernel function for Fourier transform is e raised to minus j omega t. And for wavelength transform, again there is an integration, same appearance is there, signal to be analyzed, that is f of t is there, and only change is the kernel function. So here for wavelength transform also, if I take the wavelength transform of this signal, so this will be f of t, and then the kernel function of wavelength will come. We'll see what is the kernel function of wavelength in our subsequent slides and so on. So my conclusion is basically, my suggestion, this one, conclusion is that all the transform appearance is almost same. This looks like same. The change is in their kernel function. This is called as the kernel function. Okay. Now, kernel function of this Fourier transform is e raised to minus j omega t. So, this e raised to minus j omega t can be written in either form as e raised to minus j omega t is equal to cos of omega t. Okay, cos of omega t minus j sin of omega t. Cos of omega t minus j sin of omega t is nothing but e raised to minus omega t if you write in other form. Okay. Now suppose, for example, how this Fourier transform works. Okay, see that. For example, this is, okay, for simplicity, I take this as, okay, 0.2, okay, 0.2 second as a 0.2 second as a time period. So 0.2 second, so this will be a 5 hertz frequency. Okay. Now, in Fourier domain, okay, when you take a Fourier transform, you should get the peak at 5 hertz. Now, how does Fourier transform recognize it? Now see that here, so for example, when frequency is omega t is 0, at that time you get two this one basis function from the one cardinal function e raised to minus omega t. From that e raised to minus omega t, you got the equation cos of omega t minus j sin of omega t. Now when I put the omega t equal to 0, I got cos of 0 as one basis function and sin of 0 as another basis function. Now what we are doing here, basically we are convolving, or basically finding the correlation between this basis function and signal to be analyzed. So this signal to be analyzed is f of t, and now my best basis function is cos 0. Now my signal, original signal is of 5 hertz and my basis function is of 0 hertz. When I am trying to find out the correlation, correlation will give you the similarity. So apparently 0 hertz frequency cosine wave and the sine wave of my original signal is sine wave of 5 hertz. Correlation will be 0, and then again I will take another basis function of sine of omega t. I will try to find out the correlation of this one. So correlation, this sine is this basis function is having frequency equal to 0 hertz. My original signal is of 5 hertz. So correlation in the first case when omega t equal to 0 will be 0. Hence my Fourier transform will be having a 0 value. Fourier transform value will be 0 and 0. Now when I change omega t equal to 1, okay, now from the same cardinal function e raised to minus omega t, which I have written in our other form as a cos of omega t minus j omega t, here I will put omega t equal to 1, so I got a cosine wave of 1 hertz. Okay, assume that I got a cosine wave of 1 hertz and then sine wave of 1 hertz. So I got another set of a basis function which is derived from the kernel. And then I take the first basis function of cos 1 hertz and I try to match it with the sine wave of 5 hertz. Definitely there will not be any matching because my basis function is having a cosine wave and my original signal is having a sine wave. Original signal frequency is 5 hertz, basis function frequency is 1 hertz. So it will not match, or there will not be any much correlation. So it will be having 0 value. Similarly, I will take another basis function which is derived from the sine of omega t, or sine of 1, omega t is 1, so sine of 1 hertz, my original signal is of 5 hertz. Again, if I try to find out the correlation, it will be 0, and then overall correlation will be 0, hence my Fourier transform of second, when omega t is equal to 1, it will be again 0, so that 1. Now, if I continue, again, this, I am increasing omega t value from 0 to infinity, I will get a set of basis function. How many set of basis function? Infinite numbers of basis function I'll get. For every frequency, for every value of omega t, I'll get two sets. One is cosine and another one is sine, or an even. Okay, and then I'm trying to find the correlation between that basis function and the signal to be analyzed. Now, when omega t equal to 5, at that time, what will happen basically? This sine cosine wave will be also having a 5 hertz, and then when I take that one and when I try to find out basically a correlation, my original signal is sine wave which is starting from 0, and my cosine basis function is basically a cosine wave which is starting from this one, so that will not give me a high value of correlation. Okay, so there also it will help. But now, if I take the sine wave of 5 hertz and cosine wave of 5 hertz, they are matching, and then similarity will be larger, hence correlation coefficient will be larger, and overall I'll get the large correlation coefficient, and then at 5 hertz I'll get maximum value of this one. So I'll get 1 peak at 5 hertz. Okay, got this one. So up to 4 it was minimum. Okay, so I got, and then again if I increase the value of omega t equal to 6, what will happen? When omega t equal to 6, then basically my Fourier, this one, basis function, cosine basis function will be having 6 hertz. If I try to match with 5 hertz sine wave, it will not match. Again, sine wave of 6 hertz, if I am trying to match with this one, sine wave of 5 hertz, it will not match. So I will get a 0 like this. So even if I work on increasing n equal to infinity, I'll get the zero value. So I got 1p at 3 plus. So this way, this Fourier transform works. So this will give the information about, okay, what are the contents or what are the frequencies in the signal, original signal. That information will be given by the Fourier transform. Okay. So 5 hertz original signal is there, which is analyzed by the help of this one. So here the building blocks which are used in Fourier transform are sine waves and cosine waves. So see that on the slide, complex function, okay, representation through the simple building blocks, that is, okay, that is nothing but your basis function or kernel function. Generally, basis functions are derived from the kernel function. So these are called as the kernel function, and by changing the value of this omega t, you get the set of basis functions. Okay, so basis functions are derived from the kernel function. Okay, now, so here your kernel function contains the sine wave and cosine wave. These are the building blocks which are used in this one. So recall Fourier transform, how does it work? Okay, uses the complex exponential as sinusoid as building block. So e raised to j omega t is given by cos of omega t plus j sin of omega t, or e raised to minus omega t would be cos of omega t minus j sin of omega t. So for every frequency or for each frequency complex exponential, the sinusoid at that frequency is compared with the original signal. Means when you are comparing, you are finding the correlation, and if correlation is larger, you get the large Fourier transform coefficient. If correlation is smaller, you get the smaller coefficient. So definitely correlation will be larger when, okay, this basis function frequency is matching or it is similar to the signal to be analyzed, then correlation coefficient will be larger. So if the signal consists of that frequency, the correlation is high, and hence you get the large Fourier transform coefficient. Otherwise, you get the if the signal does not have any spectral component of a frequency, okay, the correlation at that frequency is low, and hence you get the zero output of a small Fourier transform coefficient, and this way it works. Now, this is an example, okay, first frequency or first signal. First thing is that this is the cosine wave. Second thing is that in the first x1t, it's having 5 hertz, twice pi ft, f is 5 hertz, okay. So, if I take the Fourier transform of my first signal, what I will get? I will get 1 peak at 5 hertz, rest of the time it will be 0. Only one peak at 5 hertz, rest of the time, okay, less it will be 0 because no other frequency components are present. Okay. Second signal is x2t, okay, which is cos of twice pi 25t, means twice pi ft, f is 25 hertz, so second signal is 25 hertz. Now, if I take the Fourier transform of this one, I will get one peak at 25 hertz, rest of the time it will be 0. Third one is x3 is cos of twice pi 50t. So I'll get one basically peak at 50 hertz, rest of the time it will be 0. So Fourier transform will be like this. For first one, it will be having one peak at 5 hertz. For second x2, it will be having one peak at 25 hertz. At x3, it will be having one peak at 50 hertz. So we got these three peaks from this one. Now, I have x4t, which is just a combination of this one, x1, x2. If I add instantaneously at every instant of time, if I add x1 with x2 and x3, so cos of 2 pi 5t plus cos of 2 pi 25t plus cos of 2 pi 50t, if I add that one, I got the x4, and the signal is the upper signal, okay, which contains three frequencies. Now, if I basically take the Fourier transform, this one, the job of Fourier transform is to tell what are the frequency content in that signal. So here, there are three frequency content, so we'll get three peaks, one peak at 5 hertz, second peak at 55 hertz, and third peak at 50 hertz. Okay, so we got three peaks in the if you take the Fourier transform, this one. Now see that here the signal is stationary signal, because all the frequency components are present. If you consider any time duration, so for example from 0 to 0.3, this window, if I consider, in that window Okay, all the three frequencies are present. If I consider 0.3 to 0.6, all those three frequencies, that is 5 hertz, 25 hertz, and 50 hertz, are present. In the same way, from 0.6 to 1, I have three frequencies. So, all those frequencies are present at every instant of time. That's why it is called as a stationary signal. Okay, but do you think that in the real world, you will find such kind of signals? Okay, when we speak and when we record that signal, is it a stationary signal? Definitely, it is not a stationary signal, because frequency may change at a time. Okay, at different instant of time, different frequencies will be there. Or even if you record any real world signal, you'll find that there is a change of frequency with respect to time. So, whether that change is recorded or whether that change is reflected in Fourier transform? Absolutely not. Now, see that. For example, I have created the X5T. See, X4T is also for reference I have shown here, which is just instantaneous addition of X1, X2 and X3 added at every instant of time. I got X4T, which is nothing but a stationary signal. And now, I have X5T, which is also made up of from X1, X2T. But now, the procedure is that I have used the concatenation. Means between 0 to 0.3 second, I have a 5 hertz signal. Between 0.3 to 0.6 second, I have 25 hertz frequency. Between 0.6 to 1 second, I have 50 hertz frequency. Means, see that this is a non-stationary signal, because in every window, frequency, all those frequencies are not present, different frequencies are present. So, this is a non-stationary signal. Now, if I take the Fourier transform of this one, then I will get the three peaks, because the job of Fourier transform is to tell what are the frequency content in that signal. Okay, so here basically I'll get the three peaks, like one peak is at 5 hertz, another peak is at 25 hertz, and third peak is at 50 hertz. Now see, there's a confusion, because X4 is also giving the same information, that is X4 is also giving me the three peak at, one is at 5 hertz, another is at 25 hertz, and third is at 50 hertz. X5 is a different signal, altogether different signal as compared to X4, but still I am getting the same peak, like as a 25 hertz, 50 hertz, and 5 hertz, 25 hertz, and 50 hertz. So here our Fourier transform tells, because Fourier transform does not give information about the time. Fourier transform gives the information about only the frequency. So, what kind of frequencies are present in the signal? That information we will get it from the Fourier transform. But where those frequencies are occurring, at what time, what is what is needed in our pitch signal, we want to have the information that yes, between 0 to 0.3 second, there is one signal having frequency equal to 5 hertz. Between 0.3 second to 0.6 second, another frequency is there having frequency equal to 25 hertz, and 0.6 second to 1 second is the third frequency. So that is the required information, but we don't get information about the time, we get information about only the frequency, that which frequencies are there. So here our Fourier transform tells, it's not like that we cannot use the Fourier transform for doing the analysis of non-stationary signal, but we will not get the complete information of non-stationary signal, because in non-stationary signal we want the information about the frequency as well as time. But Fourier transform is giving information about only frequency, and that is not sufficient in case of non-stationary signal. So, this is the three peaks you get. One is at 5 hertz, another one is at 25 hertz, and third one is at 50 hertz. Okay, so these three peaks you got with the Fourier transform, but that's not sufficient. Then how to solve this issue? Okay, so another transform which is there, which is nothing but the short time Fourier transform. Okay. Now, this short-time Fourier transform is basically a Fourier transform. But only thing is that it is taken for shorter duration. Okay. See that. If you look at the equation of Fourier transform equation was integration of f of t e raised to minus j omega t, dt was there. Here, if you look at the equation of this one, there is a modification of x of t by the windowing function w of t minus t dash. This is the modification. Rest of the thing is remains same, e raised to minus j omega t. This kernel function of Fourier transform and short term Fourier transform is same, that is equal to e raised to minus j omega t. What is changed here? Here only which portion of the signal is considered to calculate the Fourier transform? This is decided by the window function W of t minus t dash. Now see that, suppose for example, if I have the pip signal x5t like this one, okay, this one, and if I have considered a window size of 0.3 hertz, okay, 0.3 second. So for this 0.3 second, what I'll do, I'll consider only the signal of 0.3 second, remaining signal I'll make it 0. How it is possible? So for example, you have a function like having amplitude equal to 1 up to 0 to 0.3 second, and then after that, say function such that it will be having amplitude equal to 0. If you okay, multiply it with the original signal, you will get only the basically portion of the signal from 0 to 0.3 second. Now take the Fourier transform that one. Okay, so if you take the Fourier transform from 0 to 0.3 second, you will get a information that there is a 5 hertz difference. Now this window is shifted to the right. Now window size is 0.3 second. So now my window is considering only the information from 0.3 to 0.6 second. Okay, and now I'm taking, see, I'm not considering the information below or signal before 0.3 second, or I'm not considering the signal after 0.6 second. I'm considering the signal only from 0.3 to 0.6 second. Now if I take the Fourier transform, the job of Fourier transform is to tell what are the frequency content. So in between 0.3 second to 0.6 second, there is 25 hertz frequency. So this 25 hertz frequency peak will be there at 25 hertz. Initially here it was a 5 hertz, then now between 0.3 to 0.6 second it is 25 hertz. Now if I shift my window to the right from 0.6 second to 0.2 second to 0.9 second. Now in this basically the frequency under consideration is 50 hertz. So if I take the Fourier transform of this signal, then I will get the value of 50 hertz peak. So now I got the information that yes, between 0 to 0.3 second I got a frequency of 5 hertz, 0.3 to 0.6 second frequency is 25 hertz, 0.6 second onward frequency is 50 hertz. So, okay, whatever the problem which was there in Fourier transform, this problem is somewhat solved with the help of short current transform. What modification is done? Okay, by using the windowing function and the equation, if you look at the equation, this windowing function is used W of t minus t dash. This function is used which will window the original signal to be analyzed. Means this will consider the part of the signal to be analyzed. So this modification is done in the Fourier transform and that becomes a shortened Fourier transform. Okay. But here there are two questions. Number one, okay. Number one is that how to select the window size. Here we know that the frequency signal is different signal is there at this one 0 to 0.3 second there is a signal of 5 hertz, 0.3 to 0.6 second there is a signal of this one 25 hertz and then 0.6 onward there is a, because this is artificial generated signal. But in real world, how to decide? Because we don't know at what time which frequency will come. So that is the problem in short and Fourier transform. So how to select the window size? That is the main issue. Okay. Now window size should be selected such that within that window your signal should be stationary. Then and then your, because after all short and Fourier transform is also a Fourier transform, and this Fourier transform works well for stationary signal. So within that window your signal should be stationary. So beforehand we don't know whether the signal is stationary or not. So that is one issue. Another thing is that what kind of window we should select, because there are so many windowing functions, like I said, triangular window is there, Gaussian window is there, square window is there, and so on. So there are several windows. Basically, select the window such that this one it will cover the entire signal so that there will not be any loss of signal and so on. But okay, that is the difficulty in short-term Fourier transform. Another difficulty of short-term Fourier transform is its time frequency resolution. What is my resolution basically? Resolution means it is the ability of the system to tell smallest change in the parameter. For example, if I consider my wristwatch, what is the resolution of this one? Wristwatch? It will give me a change of 1 second. Okay. Can I use this wristwatch again for measuring the time in marathon? Absolutely not, because its resolution is very, very fast. So I have to use the stopwatch which can measure the smallest change of time, like as a 1 millisecond or fraction of a second or something like that. So because the resolution of that this one is stopwatch is very, very short. Okay. Or for example, you are familiar with ammeter, okay? And you have circuit and you are connected this ammeter in series, and one ammeter is measuring the current in ampere, another ammeter is measuring the current in microampere. So A ampere is measuring the current in ampere, and B ammeter is there which will measure the current from microampere to ampere, so right that way. Now when I change the current in the circuit from 0 to 50 microampere, my A ammeter will not show much any reflection, but in a B ammeter will show much reflection because its resolution is very, very high. Okay. Now, time frequency resolution means what basically? Time frequency resolution means resolution of time as well as resolution of frequency. That we'll study in our subsequent slide. So now in this case basically, what is the problem with this shortened Fourier transform is that, I have taken on y-axis, I have taken the frequency, and on x-axis, I have taken the time. Now, once you have selected the window size, fixed window size, now whatever may be the window, whatever may be the time, your window size will be same, and whatever may be the frequency, your window size will be same. Okay, so that will create a problem, because what we need? We need a transform whose window should be variable. Whose window should be variable. For high frequency, you know that for low frequency, time period is large. Time period is large because time is inversely proportional to frequency. Time period is large. For high frequency, time period is small. Okay. So for doing the high frequency analysis, our window size should be small, and for doing the low frequency analysis, our window size should be large. But this is not happening in case of STFT, because once you have decided the window, whatever may be the frequency or whatever may be the time, that window size will be fixed, and that will create a problem for doing the analysis of non-stationary signal. Okay. So, what is the solution for that? So, solution for this one is basically a Fourier transform. Because here, its time frequency resolution is really high. Okay. So, you know that narrow window will give you good time resolution. Because if you have a narrow window, definitely it will be able to distinguish between the two time events. Okay. Which are occurring at different instant of time. Larger window, you will get the good frequency resolution, because larger window means is inverse the proportional frequency, so it will be able to detect the change in frequency in small side, small frequency. Okay, so larger window is good for detecting the small frequency, wider window, good. That's why it is called as it is having good frequency resolution, and the narrower window. You will be able to detect a small change in time. So that's why narrow window is considered as having good time resolution, and wider window is considered as a good frequency resolution. Okay. But now, see that window lengths define the time and frequency resolution. And here, Heisenberg principle, Heisenberg inequality principle is that, can we have a good time resolution and frequency resolution at the same time? Absolutely not. Because, time and frequency are inversely proportional. So, if you are going for good time resolution, forget about the frequency resolution. And if you are going for good frequency resolution, forget about the time resolution. So, you have to trade off between time and frequency resolution. So, according to the Heisenberg principle, one cannot have an arbitrary good time and frequency resolution, and one must trade for the other, because their product, according to Heisenberg principle, delta T into delta F is greater than or equal to 1 upon 4 pi, okay? Where delta T is nothing but the time resolution and delta F is nothing but the frequency resolution. So, delta T will tell you how well two spikes in the time can be separated from each other. In the transform domain, and delta F will tell you how well two spectral components can be separated from each other in the transform domain. So that is the basically delta F. Now, so you have to trade off between time resolution and frequency resolution. You cannot achieve good time resolution and frequency resolution at the same time because they are inversely proportional to each other. Okay. Another thing is that both time and frequency resolution cannot be arbitrarily high. Okay, because see that. Or take another example. Okay. Suppose for example, you are standing on the road. Okay, and you would like to measure this one, the speed of the car. Okay, so you would like to measure the speed of the car, and you are standing on the road. Car is moving. You are not in the car. Okay, is it possible that okay at this time, at that is this instant, or at this location, can I measure the speed of the car? It's not possible. What we have to do, basically, we have to give a some time duration. Like for example, we should have to this point A and point B. When that car comes at point A, okay, we'll start basically stopwatch, and then when it reaches to point B, we'll stop that one. Then we know that distance ds, and we know that time change dt. So ds by dt will give the speed of this one. So even in mechanical system also, we cannot tell the at what time what frequency is occurring. Similarly, in electrical system also, at what time what this speed is there. In electrical system also, we cannot tell at what time what frequencies are occurring. So we have to give some time duration. Okay, so we cannot precisely know at what time what instances the frequency component is located. We can only know the interval of frequencies are present in which time interval. Okay, so this is possible with the help of Jouglet transform. Okay, so Jouglet transform overcomes the problem of resolution problem of short-time Fourier transform, that is STFT, by variable window size. See that. What is the problem? What is the problem of Fourier transform? Fourier transform was giving only information about the frequency. It was not giving information about the time. Then that problem was solved by the short time Fourier transform by okay considering the window, okay, and this, that is taking the Fourier transform shorter interval, and then this one. But this was not a complete solution because in Fourier short time Fourier transform, once window size is decided, then you cannot change that window size for okay, even if there is a change in frequency or even if there is a change in time. So that was the problem. Now, what is the requirement for doing the analysis of low frequency? For doing the analysis of low frequency, we want a wider window, and for doing the analysis of high frequency, we want a smaller window. So we should have a transform which is a flexible, which can give the window size as a larger window, which can give the window size as a smaller window. For larger window, when there is a larger window, we'll be able to detect the small frequency. When there is a smaller window, we'll be able to detect the small frequency. When there is a mid-size window, we'll be able to detect the mid frequency. So we should have the basically a transform which can vary its window size. And this is possible. This property is there in the Jouglet transform where we get the variable window size. Okay, and because of that, we can do the analysis of low frequency as well as by analysis of high frequency at different window size. So, Jouglet transform overcomes the problem of short-term Fourier transform by variable window size. So, a narrower window is used for doing the analysis of high frequency, and wider window is used for doing the analysis of lower frequency. So this works well even if the signals are mainly analyzed for consists of slowly varying characteristics with the occasional short high frequency burst. And here also a simple principle holds, that is delta t into delta a should be greater than or equal to 4 pi. And this is possible with a one kernel function which is called as the Jouglet, and this function is used to window the signal. I think today we'll stop here, and tomorrow we'll continue the complete that and Jouglet and its application. So in today's session, if you have any doubt up to this point, you can ask. And tomorrow at 4 o'clock we'll continue this one, and then at the end I'll get application of Jouglet for any person. Yes.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir, for your informative session. I think you have covered basics of Jouglet in comprehensive manner. I hope all the participants have got it. so that in tomorrow's session where you are going to explain case studies, they will not face any difficulty.
So first I'll explain this Fourier transform, shorter Fourier transform. In conjunction with that one, I'll explain Fourier transform tomorrow, and then after that, I'll take the study of
So the question is, which is the best book for beginners to understand signal processing by wavelet transform?
That's what I said, these Rao Bopodikar books, and it is, I forgot to tell you that in the beginning, there is a good book which is written by Indian author, he's from Chennai, and his name is K.P. Soman. So K.P. Soman's book is also a good book on understanding the wavelet. But for the beginners and those who hate mathematics, I told you that The World According to Wavelet by Bartosz Kubart, this book is a really good book to study wavelet.
Yes.
But for those who are familiar with mathematics and understanding, they use this introduction to wavelet transform by K.P. Soman.
Okay, sir. Next question is from Amol. He is asking, which kind of wavelet transform is best for EEG signal processing?
Okay. I think I'll be able to answer better, or you get the answer of this one once I cover the wavelet part. Because today I have covered only this one, Fourier transform and short term. So tomorrow, definitely you'll get the answer of this one.
We'll keep this question for tomorrow.
One more question is how to compute coefficients of wavelet transform. That I think you are going to cover again in tomorrow's session. Has got disconnected due to bandwidth problem. So he's saying thank you to you, Professor.
You are actually today, unfortunately, see, I am conducting this one entire working program for YCC Nagpur from morning to morning. And then it was connected with this one, by land, this one, landline. But unfortunately, at 4 o'clock, this got disconnected, so I have connected with mobile. I was worried whether I will be able to complete or not because of mobile. But thankfully, I could complete this session. So hope tomorrow there will be a good connectivity at my end also.
Yes, sir.
Go ahead,
please.
Any question?
No, such all the questions are based on wavelet, but since we are not covered.
Tomorrow I am going to explain all those
things. Yes. So in that session, we will cover these questions.
Yes.
So, I request Samrata ma'am to give a thank you note for Kokri sir.
Good afternoon all, I am Amruta Moise, faculty of ENTSA department of GC Karad. Consider the occasion as an honor to extend the word of thanks. I may like to express our sincere thanks to Dr. Kokri sir for giving an excellent coverage to the wavelet and its application in image processing and the case studies. Sir, indeed, your words have inspired to all of us. Thank you very much, sir. Tomorrow, all the participants will meet exactly sharp at 10 a.m. Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Kokre, sir. We'll meet tomorrow.
Sure, sir.
So this concludes our second day of this signal image and video processing a practical approach 2020. I hope all the participants are having a good time with this FDP. So I conclude this session. Thank you all.